April 19th, 2015. I'm Matt Dillahunty, and this is Tracie Harris.
Howdy.
How are you?
Okay.
So we're back after a few weeks hiatus and some crew changes and all kinds of stuff, but I need to let you know that we're not currently live streaming over Ustream for today, but it's still at Channel Austin, which I guess you might know if you're actually hearing me, and maybe, I don't know, let other people know who might have tuned in through Ustream that we're streaming through Channel Austin today only. Running with a skeleton crew, there may be audio issues, we don't know if the phones are working yet, we, you know, it could be a mess, or it might be the most awesome show ever.
Yeah.
Don't know. The joys of public access TV and live TV. But you want to actually start off talking a little bit about religion and family while
Yeah, I did. So, you know, this weekend I'm going to be doing ReasonCon, the weekend coming up.
Yes.
So, North Carolina, here we come. And I think me and Beth will both be out there. And the topic that I'll be speaking on is religion and the family. And I was pulling a lot of viewer mail that dealt with family issues, like people that had contacted us with concerns about family. And in churning through all of that, you know, just kind of seeing the themes and the patterns that keep recurring, it became, I kept trying to articulate, I guess, the point that I kept seeing that was annoying to me. And finally, I was able to really look at it and say, what's bothering me here is the way that, you know, religion seems to try to own the healthy family, like the family values and,
right,
you know, the family model. And all of these things about family that especially fundamentalist religion promotes as, you know, having the best answers to...
It's ours.
Yeah. The family is just, and anything that deviates is wrong, is bad, it has to be squelched, is problematic in some way. But what I noticed is the religions that are most hardcore in claiming ownership of the family and family values seem to be the least family-oriented in the sense of rather than using their religion to actually encourage family togetherness, they use the family to bolster the religion. So they're actually using family ties, like parental authority and, you know, children's desire to please the parents and people's fear of losing those bonds or upsetting other family members, living in a house where you have to get along. All of those things that are inherent to family life seem to be put to task in making sure that the family members adhere to the religion. It's used in a coercive way to make the family members behave and stay in line and conform to generally what the parents are promoting in the household. But sometimes some of these letters are actually situations where the parents don't agree, where you may have a father or a mother who have deconverted and they're afraid to say anything. No one in the family knows, and they're terrified that their spouse is going to find out and divorce them. And this, to me, is the idea of them understanding that in that family, the family that they have set up and been a part of, that if they deviate from the religion, they will be out, like outside of that family. They will suffer consequences. They will potentially lose those family ties. They could be broken. They could be strained. And it seems as though the religion works in these particular instances. Like I say, it's mostly the fundamentalist sects, the people that are most interested in the religious conformity, that are utilizing the family in this way.
So they're less. So religions are often. I don't know if it's fair to say they're giving lip service to caring about, you know, a good, healthy family.
Yeah.
It may be that the primary reason for caring about a good, healthy family is to ensure that there's a healthy family participating to bolster religion.
And yes.
When the family begins to crumble, then you cut off the dead branches type
yeah.
thing.
Yeah. I even found one website that I'll be talking about this upcoming weekend where this is actually stated outright, where they basically say, the purpose of the family is to go out and promote the religion. And I was just like, wow, you know, there it is. Like, this is what I've been seeing over and over again. And here is a religious website that just basically says, this is why you want like a healthy religious minded family, because that's the way to go out into the world and promote God to everybody else.
Yeah, I think there was definitely an aspect of that in the kind of Southern Baptist tradition that I grew up in. It wasn't, you know, it's not overt. And
no, and I don't even think the people that are doing it understand that they are using their families as basically tools of the religion. I don't think they understand that in the...
Well, I think they would think that that's a good thing.
I think that they might think it's good, but I also don't think they would necessarily immediately agree to it. I think that they would say, you know, no, religion is making my family better. And it's like, no, your family is being used to promote the religion. And it only flies when everyone conforms. The moment there's like an ounce of nonconformity, suddenly the family starts to strain. The religion doesn't strain, the family strains. And the people that can't conform, those are the people that are going to suffer the most, but really the whole family structure suffers.
Yep. And I've spoken to former Mormons, who talk about how they were basically instructed to make sure that any issues that they had in their family, anything that wasn't going particularly well, was never made public. You know, they had a public face that they had to present to everybody, and they needed to do this to ensure that the church didn't get negative attention, because if it comes out that, you know, whatever religion, Mormonism, it's Southern Baptist, whatever denomination, if you have a parade of families in distress, then that looks bad for the religion, because it's yeah. purportedly able to make your life and your family better.
Yeah, and there's a lot of that in the letters that we get. There's a whole lot of people hiding the fact that there is a strain on the family. So some of the people who've actually come out and faced that strain or confronted the family and said, look, I don't believe this, and then had to deal with that fallout. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of situations where when that fallout hits, the response from the rest of the family is, you just keep it quiet. Like, don't say anything. Don't tell your brothers and sisters that you're an atheist. Don't talk to the children and tell them you don't believe in God anymore, husband or wife, you know?
Yeah.
And so there's this idea that of secrecy and dishonesty that is then bred, because they can't allow the person who is not conforming to the religion to be open, because they are afraid that might influence other family members. And so they end up basically coercing children if they live at home, or threatening spouses, one another, with disharmony in the home. Should you tell the children, or should you speak to the children about this? I'm taking them to church and I don't want you questioning this in front of them. Mm-hmm. And so there's this whole idea of, it's not so much that you don't believe as that you may not conform. So don't believe, and that's fine. Just keep conforming, and we'll just keep pretending that everything is, you know, in line with the religion, and we'll proceed like that, and it'll all be fine. You just have to lie.
And I think that, you know, looking back, I'm not completely sure, because there was very little disagreement on these issues at the time that I was in the family. But if you think about political issues, mm-hmm. you know, I have family members, we're going to disagree on various things, and my recollection of this may not be accurate, but it seemed to me that if we disagreed on something that wasn't a clear part of the religion, like where money should go,
right.
where the government should be spending money, then there was not any, you know, this hush-hush, or you had a disagreement, and you may think that the other person's an ass and you don't talk
right.
to them, whatever else. But if you had a disagreement on a political issue that was also tied up with what the religions believe, maybe it was abortion, maybe it was, you know, some issue along those lines, then it wasn't so much a keep it to yourself. It was, you're no longer biblically correct. You're no longer in accordance with our religious beliefs, and that's a problem.
Yeah, yeah. And I think that while you could probably find examples of families using other things, I would say probably even weird things like, you know, love of sports or love of some kind of gaming or something. There might be families that are into that to an extent that when someone doesn't participate, they feel left out. So I'm not saying that, you know, only religion can do this, but I think that when I think about other things that cause these types of rifts, generally speaking, I don't see it happening as frequently or with the magnitude that it happens in the family. I think close to it might have been, like, years ago, racial issues. Like, if somebody were to date or marry somebody outside the race, that might be competitive with this.
Which, you know, still happens, as does the, you know, having a gay kid.
Yeah, that will cause issues. But when I thought of that, what interested me was that's usually causing issues because of religion.
Right.
So it's, you know, that's kind of an interesting thing,
too. I had relatives who were against interracial marriages because they thought they were ungodly. You know, that this was, they had a religious reason until a couple joined their church. And then they got to know them and interacted with them. And then all of a sudden, not only were they fine with it, but God had evidently, you know, either changed his mind or God had, they had misunderstood what God wanted.
Yeah, they weren't understanding correctly.
And so it got removed from the list of religious issues for which I will ostracize you and think you're terrible just because of one nice family.
Yeah. And this is made clear. I mean, it's interesting to me how many people write in not having come out, basically understanding that there is a principle already at work in the family that you don't come out with
this.
And so the family builds this environment of fear that is set up to prevent the person from feeling comfortable ever coming out with something like this. So it's almost like this weird inoculation against it to basically say, we want to set up the family in such a way that if one of our children or one of the spouses or, you know, anybody involved starts to deviate from this, they know not to say anything.
They know there's a risk. We hear this all the time from people who are either talking about coming out or they're just transitioning. There's a reason why Recovering from Religion has the Hotline Project, mm-hmm. which is now live. So if you're in this situation where you're having difficulties with a transition, either from, you know, religion to not a non-religious worldview, or just trouble in general along those lines, just look up Recovering from Religion Hotline Project, and there's somebody you can call who can, you know, direct you to resources, because we've seen people, we've seen families essentially run out of town. We have seen people kicked out of their homes, cut off from their families, cut off from their social networks and support groups. There's a real risk to it, and one of the things that I say when I talk to people about potentially coming out is make sure you are comfortable with all of the potential risks. And, you know, if you think that your life is likely to be worse afterwards, then, you know, maybe hold off. Wait until we continue changing the world so that there's perhaps less risk involved.
And I've seen both. Like, I've seen people that have contacted us to say, my family will freak out. And then they write back later and say, I told them, and they were freaked out for a little bit, but they chilled out and they're taking it much better than I thought. And then we get other letters from people who are like, you know, I think my family would be okay with it. And oh my gosh, then I told them and it wasn't okay at all. Like, it was a nightmare. And I wish I had just kept my mouth shut, because now everything is like just crushed. My parents hate me. So sometimes it can be difficult to gauge, you know, I mean, but still the best person to gauge is the person who's lived in it.
Yep.
So even if you're wrong, you still have probably a better chance of gauging your family's reaction than we would at our email list. So if you write to us, we'd probably just write back to say, consider the consequences and make that decision very prudently.
Read Greta Christina's book on coming out, which, you know, talks about all the people she interviewed, and of all of them, only one of them regretted it and wished it had never happened. The rest of them may have gone through difficulties, but things turned out better in the end, or at least they were fine with the results at the end. Because I don't know your family.
And we think about it in terms of children so often, or young people coming out. But I mean, for spouses, it's a nightmare too.
And there have been a number of emails from people who, you know, we started off, we both believe the same thing. Now I don't.
Yeah.
And we don't know what's going to happen with the relationship. Are we going to stay together? Are we going to get divorced? What are we going to teach the kids now that we believe different things?
Sometimes the other spouse that remains religious, it becomes like their whole mission and their whole focus to just, you know, reintegrate that distant spouse back into the fold, to where they lose sight of any other aspects of the relationship.
Yeah, they're terrified of what, you know, oh, we used to both believe, and we were kind of half-assed Easter Christmas Christians, but now my spouse doesn't believe anymore, and I'm terrified of the impact this is going to have on my kids. So now I've got my kids in church Sunday morning, Sunday night, Monday night, Wednesday night, you know. We've got to work extra hard to undermine the
which then freaks out the other spouse.
Yes.
Because they're just like, I talked to my spouse about it, and then they became uber religious, and they weren't before, and I don't know what happened, and, you know, why they've kind of gone nuts now. And, I mean, it's just, it's a mess, some of the things that it does.
I have a friend of mine who used to blog as an atheist, and her spouse was supposedly okay with it for the entire time. As soon as they got divorced, he suddenly became super Catholic in order to win a custody battle. And unfortunately, he got a judge, and I think that it's hard to say what the likelihood is of a judge going along with this, but if you live in a country where most people believe or have been indoctrinated into this idea that there's something good or positive about belief in general, even if they're not really that into it, then being viewed as the godless heathen may put you on the losing side of a custody case or similar issues.
Yeah, when I was sat in with nonprofits recently, and one of the articles that I brought in had like a recent survey where people were queried about different attitudes about religious belief and religious practice, and it was surprising. I wish I could remember the percentage. It was like a very high percentage of people who were secular who rated that religious belief or faith and attendance at church is, you know, admirable. And it's like, these are people that are secular, like secular-minded, and still pay this homage to religious, just simply religious facade.
Yeah, and it's, you know, that is something that I think is going to be a little harder to fix. You know, I have atheist friends and people I've worked conventions and stuff with who will talk about how wonderful the Sermon on the Mount is. And I didn't think so. So one of the things I did is I went to ironchariots.org and I did a verse-by-verse deconstruction of the Sermon on the Mount, showing, you know, hey, here's some good things, here's some not-so-good things, here's some pretty bad things, here's some encouragement for a victim-like mentality of, you know, hey, if you're living right by God, the whole world's going to hate you. So if the whole world hates you, that must mean you're living right by God, which, wow, talk about encouraging this sort of victim mentality. And I think maybe we need to do more consciousness raising in that area, that, you know, religion and morality, or religion and being a good person, don't go hand in hand, and that there's nothing particularly laudable about what I view as gullibility or buying into superstitions. And if we can demonstrate the things that you're talking about how religions don't actually care about encouraging a healthy family relationship, except in the arena where it benefits the religions, I think that might go a long way.
And I don't want to say that all religions and all families are, you know, guilty of this. I mean, I honestly think the more fundamentalist they become, you know, the higher, the more letters we get. We don't get too many letters from people who are like, hey, my family's very laid back about religion. And we go to the UU church down the road, and I'm really scared to tell them I'm atheist. I mean, we don't get that letter. Ever. So it's almost always, you know, my dad's a deacon, or I'm a deacon, and I don't know what to do now. And so those are the letters we're getting, people that are very involved in very evangelical sects.
The good news is the world's changing. You know, the nuns, the N-O-N-E's, the ones with no religious affiliation, are an incredibly rapidly increasing group by most polls. You have Recovering from Religion, you know, a social network for people who are recovering from religion. There's the Hotline Project as part of that. There's a Secular Therapist Project for people who actually need therapy and don't want to be told that what they need is Jesus or that they need to go to church. You've got, what was the other one I was going to name? What's the matter, Tracie? You can't read my mind?
I don't know.
In addition to those, there are a number of other groups out there that are focused on this. You know, the opportunity to transition. We're building more local communities so people have a place to land when they find their way out. And we're kind of changing the perception. And what we're seeing is that younger people, in particular, seem to be
more responsive,
willing to come out, more comfortable with coming out. Their views are changing on certain things.
More open to having friends who are atheists if they're not.
It's interesting to see, you know, how the trend continues and, you know, whether or not, you know, does it stall out at some point? Do people get to some age and then a switch flips back? You know, we don't know. But I'm convinced that the best thing we can continue to do to change the world, to put a better face on secularism, the atheist, is to be out. Anybody who can be out, who's comfortable being out, so that it's very hard to vilify the people that you know, that you know to be good people. But you want to throw a caution to the wind and try to take some calls?
Yeah, and we've got a list now.
Yeah, so this should be Zach in Charlotte. How you doing? Can you hear us?
Hello.
Zach? I'm going to put Zach back on hold.
That's too bad.
Just in case. But we'll go to Emily in Wisconsin. Can you hear us?
Oh, man.
Sorry?
Try again.
Try again. Okay. We'll try for Zach again. Hello? Zach, you're on the air. All right, so that's not working. I'm just going to go through all the lines and we'll try. We've got, is it Sam in New York?
Yeah.
Hey, we got somebody.
Thank you, Sam. How you doing?
I'm doing good. How about you guys?
Okay.
Could be better, but we'll see.
Yeah, phone's not working, huh?
Having a little trouble, yeah.
Well, yours is, so I don't know why any of the others wouldn't be.
Yeah, it's weird. What I was going to ask you guys is, what are the origins of circumcision in the Bible? How did that come about?
It came about from the covenant with Abram, who was renamed Abraham. And basically God kind of pulled Abram aside, said, hey, I'm going to make a deal with you. You're going to get all this cool stuff, and your descendants are going to be, you know, my favored, awesome people. But first, I need you to kill your own son. And then when he obeyed and tried to do that and God intervened to stop him, then he said, okay, this guy will pretty much do anything I ask, so I want you to cut off your foreskin, and then all of your family and slaves and every descendant forever will also have to cut off their foreskin. It's almost like God just made foreskins so they could be cut off.
He had that foresight. There was a plan.
Yeah, I agree. I find it patently ridiculous, which is why I made fun of it in a talk that I did in Australia. So.
And the reason I ask is because I have a brother who's always been kind of shy with girls. Like when I try to set him up with somebody, he always just says, no, I'm all right, that kind of thing. But the other week, he confided in me and told me that, and not to get too nasty about things, but that his circumcision made him not feel anything. He lost pretty much all his feeling down there.
There's a lot of problems in this area, and not everybody's in disagreement. There were some studies that showed potential health benefits, but those studies are dubious at best. One of the things that, you know, they talked about was actually keeping it clean, and I can speak as, I was a teenager at one point. I'm pretty sure it's not that hard to get somebody to clean their penis in the shower.
Right.
I think it's like vigorously cleaned on a regular basis. But one of the things is that people, you know, when this came about as a kind of Jewish ritual, it needed to be done, you know, by the eighth day, and this is how we ended up with this kind of automatic circumcision for infants, and it's something that I'm vehemently opposed to. If somebody, you know, when they reach the age of reason and consent, decide that they would rather be circumcised, then I'm fine with them doing that on their own. And I don't see any good reason for doing it, you know, as a de facto standard to anybody or to infants, especially without consent. The benefits I don't think are there, and I'm a big fan of people being the, you know, the sovereign ruler of their own body. And if you're, you know, really concerned about health issues, then it seems to me that you could discuss it with the individual before they become sexually active and allow them to make a decision on their own. I don't want to equate it with like female genital mutilation, which is quite often and almost always far more impactful with regard to the individual's ability, because there's millions of circumcised men who can still feel and have sex and function. But your brother has an example of something where it went horribly, horribly wrong, which to me is just one more reason not to be running around doing it until somebody can actually consent to it.
I'm in total agreement. I asked my mother,
right,
actually, why she did it. I don't know. It's weird to ask a mother that thing, but I just had to know. And she threw out the health thing that, you know, she just thought it'd be healthier. Her doctors were saying that.
Was probably told that. I mean, she probably was told that.
And a lot of people just do it just because everybody does it. So there's another aspect to all of this, which is once it becomes the norm, then there, you know, when you're in the shower with all the other boys and you see that your penis looks different from everybody else's, there are people who prefer circumcised penises and there are people who prefer uncircumcised. And when you shift what the norm is, you are basically putting everybody else in some other category where they may appear to be, you know, freakish, even though they're the one that's still intact. Or vice versa. And this is why, you know, there's so many issues with this that go to body image, that go to people's self-confidence, that go to, you know, not just whether or not do you feel pleasure and can you engage in sexual activity, but it's are you comfortable enough with how your genitalia appears that you're willing to share it with somebody else? I mean, I don't, you know, it's not a naturalistic fallacy that I'm using to say we should just leave people intact. I'm talking about an issue of consent. And what's happened for years is that people just did it. And sometimes parents weren't even consulted. You know, hey, you had a baby boy? Cool. We're going to go ahead and do this because we know everybody wants it done and it's just the thing we do and we can charge you extra money for it, by the way, because we're going to do one more procedure on you just after the delivery. And it became just the thing to do, and I think it's
that. Some other procedures that we used to do routinely on children, like removing tonsils if they were in the hospital for something else. I mean, we no longer preemptively just take your tonsils out. You know, that kind of, there's more of a watch and wait mentality, I think, now in medical ethics, where it's like, let's just see if a problem is going to occur. And this is one of those lingering areas where we seem to just say, let's just head off problems by just removing it, even though there's no medical need to remove it at this point, and it seems to be purely cosmetic.
And lastly, I don't know your brother's actual situation, but there are plastic surgeons and those who will perform procedures to replace foreskin and do corrective surgery. I don't know if it's possible for him to regain feeling and become functional. But it's something potentially worth looking into.
Thanks. The other thing, well, when he was telling me this, he was also saying that it had other effects on him, that he would use drugs. He had problems with drugs and alcohol for almost a decade. And I don't know if he's just using this as an excuse, but he kind of says,
does it matter?
You know, I feel like I'm never going to get married. I feel like, you know, all that stuff. And just he is just kind of always down in the dumps about that. So I never knew. But, I mean, it's just terrible. I wish they would wait for you know, like you guys said, they can ask, or, you know, so you can make your own decision about that.
Yeah. I don't know if you were going to jump in on that.
No, I agree.
I was just going to say, you know, the people turn to alcohol and drugs for a number of issues, and I'm not a mental health expert, but it's probably a good idea if he actually speaks to somebody about it. Because if he's aware that his concerns about his genitalia and whether or not he's going to, you know, find a partner, if those things are driving him to do more harm to his life, then he might benefit from speaking to somebody. And this is the type of, you know, harm I was talking about when I talked about body image issues and whether or not you're, you know, you're comfortable with how you work, how you look, how you function. But thanks for the call, Sam.
Okay, thanks.
Take care.
All right, you too.
All right. Should we try Zach again? You there, Zach?
Yes, I am.
Hey, thanks for waiting.
How you guys doing?
Pretty good. How are you?
I'm great. Matt, we talked on Facebook the other day, by the way.
Okay.
I'm that dude. I was just wondering what you thought brought the universe into existence.
Don't know.
You don't know?
Nope. Do you?
Would you admit that it would have to be something beyond the universe's characteristics?
I'm not quite sure what you mean by beyond the universe's characteristics. See, I don't know enough about the actual... See, we can't get back beyond the Planck time, first of all. And I don't think I have enough information about how the universe was formed to make any sort of statement about it at all, other than we don't yet have an explanation.
Well, the way I understand it is the universe hasn't always been here. It actually came into being.
So
that would imply
It depends very much on what you actually mean. So we have, for example, Big Bang cosmology, which describes the expansion of the universe beginning at about the Planck time, but it doesn't actually tell you what the beginning was, and we don't seem to be able to actually investigate that. We've got exactly one universe. We don't have a time machine. And so there are a number of different things, including multiverses, where there are universes popping up from different places. There are a number of different possible ideas, and I don't know that I have enough information to make any kind of, you know, declarative statement about which one is more probable. Why does it matter?
But in every theory, even in say the multiverse, wouldn't you concede that they're implying that the universe originated from a place beyond its current space-time dimension? Even the multiverse would be a place of a different space-time or a different...
I would agree that the multiverse model would have a universe originating out of something that was not what the universe is, yes. That's not the only model, and I don't know that it's the only possibility. I'm wondering why this is a big deal. I mean, do you know how the universe came into existence?
All I know is that most physicists in modern cosmology says that it came into existence, implying that there's a
description.
There was no space, time, or dimension. In which there is no
space,
time.
When they talk about space time with respect to our universe, that's the space and time of our universe. Either did not exist or existed in some other form that we don't know about. But we have this space that we're inhabiting, our local presentation of the universe, and even, you know, like they'll talk about time beginning with that, but they're talking about our local time. Everything is in terms of the local presentation of our universe. Now, all the models point to that coming into existence or beginning or expanding or coming out of something else we don't know. But I'm still wondering if you have an explanation for that and why it's an issue if I don't.
Well, it's not an issue if you don't. I was just putting forth the idea that if you understand that the universe came into being, then that would also imply that there was a state in which no space or time existed.
Sure.
So there would be something greater beyond it.
No. Even if I were to concede that the universe came into existence at some point under the way you've described it, that doesn't mean that there's something greater. First of all, greater is not defined. I don't know. I don't know what.
No,
So let's say for a second, just hypothetically, that the entirety of our universe, all of space and all of time, at some point did not exist and it came into existence. What conclusion can you then draw from that?
You can draw from that there is a place, or
a place.
In my case, what
is a place?
An entity beyond our dimension, space and time.
Zach, what does it mean to say there's a place when you just said that at one point space didn't exist? Do you have any examples of a place without a space?
That's what I'm saying. I mean, I couldn't describe to you the details of that different form of space and time.
I'm talking about the fact that the language you're using borrows from things without demonstrating it. So when we talk about there's a place, we are always talking about a place within this universe, a space. I don't even know that the concept of outside of space-time makes any sense. I don't know how anything...
Of course it does, when it's been proven that space-time came into being.
But that doesn't... Even if it came into being, that doesn't mean there's something outside of space-time.
I mean, there has to be some sort of something that caused it to exist.
Why? And what does it mean for something to exist outside of space and time when existence is necessarily temporal?
It would mean that there's a model such as the multiverse or some.
But that's not
that
necessarily outside of space-time. That's not necessarily outside of space-time. That's outside
of
our local.
I would caution that you review the science if you don't think that's something beyond space and time.
Okay, we're done. I mean, you know, if you're just going to caution me to review the science, one of us has actually reviewed the science and the other one is making extrapolations that they can't justify. You want to guess which one's which?
All right, I'll present something different if you don't want to go with the cosmological argument. Does the Fibonacci sequence mean anything to you? That's found within our universe?
Sure. What about it?
Would you say that's a sign of intelligence?
No.
Perhaps a creator?
No.
What about information found within DNA that can only come from an intelligent mind?
No.
As far as we've observed.
How did you determine that sort of information can only come from an intelligent mind when all observations about that particular information shows that it comes about by natural processes?
We've never seen it come about by natural processes.
You see DNA replicate all the time and change.
But never come about originally.
Okay.
We've only
so what?
Seen
so basically, so basically, basically, you're saying that the origination of DNA, which we don't know, we don't understand, we haven't observed, that
exactly.
comes. Okay, but you've cracked the code and you've determined what it must be and that it must be from an intelligence.
No. I'm not saying I've determined 100%.
I don't care if it's 100%, Zach. You're saying that it must be from an intelligence. How did you reach that conclusion? You're not.
The type of information that we observe within DNA has only been seen to come from a mind.
No, that's
when
just wrong.
When has it
wrong.
Ever been
Go
seen
ahead.
To come from a mind? When has DNA come from a mind? Like, when have you observed that any more than we've observed it arise in nature outside
that's,
of, like, existing chains?
I'm saying we have observed neither, but
I'm right,
saying
so why would you make assumptions?
The type of information that is seen within DNA has only been observed... Has only been seen.
What do you mean, type of information?
The type of information in DNA is DNA information, and I have never seen it come from a mind ever.
I'm not saying I have. I'm saying that.
Yeah. So why would you be saying that?
So if
decoded information that completes a goal, like a recipe or a book.
Well, recipe is different than DNA. I don't see recipes generating themselves from other recipes, like out in nature, but I do see DNA replicating itself in nature. So a recipe is not quite on par with DNA.
It's true, but I'm saying the nature of the information itself. Like
Let me run this by you, right? Okay, we see, if it rains, we might observe that a pond forms, correct?
Correct.
So we watch this pond form in nature.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes there are ponds that exist that we didn't see form, right?
Correct.
And sometimes there are people that build ponds. Or like I can go to the store and get a plastic pool and blow it up and make my own backyard pond out of a plastic pool, right?
But even in the pond analogy, would you assume that the water is always needed to rush into a lower level or something like that?
Wait, no,
like
the question that I was going to ask is, if you see a person make an artificial pond,
correct,
Does that mean that then we should say that all pawns are artificially made by a mind and that there, a pawn cannot just simply arise naturally by natural processes?
I would not think that's correct at all.
Okay, so if people can make information and relay information such as a recipe, isn't it also possible that they can arise naturally, and just because you see minds creating them, that doesn't mean that all of them are created by minds?
Well, I couldn't say it's possible for it to arise naturally if I've never observed that.
Okay, but what I'm saying is that we have examples of things that people can create artificially that we know arise naturally. And you're saying that because a mind can create a code, that all codes must be created by a mind, or that at least that's how you're getting to the idea that a mind would be creating DNA.
Could I reverse that analogy on you a bit?
Sure.
And say that when you see a pawn form, it's water is always required?
Sure.
And
sure.
When you see information that not all information, but information that is coded and actually completes a goal. The only time you've ever observed
what,
that
what's
is
the goal?
A human
what's
mind
the goal?
Involved.
What's the goal?
Well, no, because human minds and didn't make DNA. And what I'm
saying. You don't know that. I mean, not human minds, obviously.
Okay, but what I'm saying is that simply observing that a human being can do something is not evidence that only a mind can do it. We mimic things in nature all the time. All the time.
I would agree with that statement. I would also say that the only time we've ever seen coded information that completes a goal is with a human intelligence.
If
or
you
a,
ignore
all
the examples yeah. that are not human That's, intelligent created,
yeah,
you're
you have to throw out everything that disagrees
examples.
With your
like what? I mean, just
like
put,
DNA.
Like DNA.
Human minds did not produce DNA, and we do see it in the natural world around us.
So let me ask this side question. Do you have any evidence of minds that can create information outside of the thinking beings that live on this planet?
Without bringing up extraterrestrials, I would say no.
Do you have evidence for extraterrestrials?
I don't have any examples of extraterrestrials.
I think they're pretty well documented, actually.
You think extraterrestrials are pretty well documented?
Well, if you look at undisclosed military files and strange videos and et cetera, yeah.
And we've left the stratosphere. We're like...
I'm torn between hanging up or just letting you talk until you continue to make yourself sound ridiculous. Why on earth do you find...
Until.
Why on earth do you find... Well, why on earth do you find the stories of extraterrestrials... I'm assuming that you think extraterrestrials have visited the Earth?
I'm not sure.
Well, you just talked about classified military documents. Would there be classified military documents about extraterrestrials that didn't visit the Earth?
I'm not one of those guys that say like, oh yeah, they came in.
Zach, you just talked about classified military documents.
Well documented.
Well documented. Sorry.
It's well documented.
And what the hell were they documented that documenting that you found so compelling if it's not aliens visiting Earth?
Well, I mean, I would say there's a difference between like visiting the Earth extensively, like on ancient aliens and stuff like that.
Zach, what the. Is well documented. Why can't you just answer the simple question? I asked, what is it that was well documented that you find convincing?
I mean, there's just been several stories of, I don't know, like planes chasing them around.
Bye.
A story is not a
thank you
a
for
well
documenting
thing.
Your credulity.
All right. Well, that was an interesting call.
Yeah. Well.
I'm glad Zach called.
It's... I'm not. I can't lie. I can lie. I just won't. So yeah, this thing. So I loved your example about the pawns because it exposes a particular fallacy and it exposes the direction of fallacy. And when Zach tried to kind of re-spin it, saying, "Oh, but we," see, it'd be like him saying, "We've only ever observed pawns coming from
right,
human beings,"
right.
Which you were going to get to, which is if we'd only ever witnessed human beings creating pawns and no pawns coming about naturally. We had no reason to think that.
Yeah.
What would our conclusion be? Well, we might mistakenly conclude that this one's more probable just because that's what we've seen. But that is basically the no black swan fallacy, that all the swans I've seen are white,
yeah.
Therefore there are no black swans. You can't use that as a foundation And when you start talking about the information coded in DNA to achieve a goal, you're already making all kinds of mistakes, because there's, first of all, there's disagreement about whether or not the genetic code should be viewed as a code and viewed as information in the same light as other things, because we're really, what we're talking about are chemicals and chemical interactions. Now, when Zach extends this to, oh, they achieve a goal. Well, no, a goal requires forethought. When a rock starts rolling down the hill, it doesn't have a goal of reaching the bottom. Okay, goals are things that are set by minds. And this is the mistake in viewing DNA in this manner that Zach was talking about when he says, oh, it achieves a goal. No, it really doesn't. It's not like evolution in the natural world has some plan and we are the pinnacle of it, like humans were the goal. We tend to look at things and stick those words on them to make them easier for us to understand. Like a gene has a goal of reproducing itself. Does it? Or is that just what it does?
Right.
The idea that there's a goal there pollutes the conversation and is what allows you to get to, oh, well, it's information and it has a goal, so therefore it comes from a mind. You're imbuing it with a goal because you're observing
language.
What it does.
It's loaded language.
But. All right, so we got Ben from El Salvador. How are you?
Fine, thank you. A bit humid, but okay. Yes, my question is about what do you say about the subjugation of natives in America by the conquistadors using Christianity?
It was bad.
yes, but over the ages, how come, at least to my ignorance, how come Christianity has continued when obviously it's just sunk us in worse situations, both sociologically and politically?
So when you're selling something like an afterlife, that appeals to people. When you're selling something like hope, that appeals to people, whether or not it's ultimately true. So one of the things that we see in religions, some of them are more forceful, some of them have more carrot and some of them have more stick. In other words, some of them offer rewards that are appealing. Whether or not they're actually real, nobody knows. And some of them offer the threats, and some of them offer a mix. And so...
And it helps if you have all the guns, and you're able to kill off a generation and then take all the children and raise them in your monastic schools. That really helps to subjugate an indigenous population if you want to convert them to your religion.
Because people who... So there are people in groups, and these individual groups may do absolutely horrific things. Take, you know, ISIS running around destroying archaeological, historic sites that conflict with their religion.
Yes.
I find that absolutely reprehensible. Do you think that they think they're evil?
Yes.
You think that ISIS thinks that they, in fact, are evil, that ISIS is evil?
Oh, no. Oh,
okay.
I think that, right.
Yeah. I'm sorry. It's a subject disagreement there. So the people who are doing this don't think that they're doing something evil. They think they're doing something good. What's happened is that their religious views have polluted their brain to the point where they think that evil things are actually good.
That's interesting, because we have a slight gang problem. And what you see with many of these gangs is that they do use religion within their own cliques. But most of it, they use to justify forgiveness for their actions, regardless how violent or cruel they are. Mm-hmm. And I definitely see some parallels with what you're seeing, but it's...
It does, though, because when you take a look at gangs, I think gang members, even the most violent gang members running around doing stuff, don't look at themselves as evil. They have a worldview where they view themselves as the victim of a society, and they are responding to the society that put them in a terrible situation, and their violence is justified. This is payback. This is, I'm getting what I deserved. This is, you took things from me and I'm now taking them back, whether it's real or and true or not. Almost nobody thinks they're evil. I'm sure there's somebody, I'll probably get an email from somebody who's proud of the fact that they're evil. But generally speaking, nobody thinks they're evil, even if we would view them that way.
Nobody that's going gung-ho doing stuff anyway.
And when you mix that, when you give someone a positive goal, like, hey, Jesus just loves people and wants to save everybody, but there's this convoluted pathway that we have to go through, and some of what he wants you to do may appear to be evil, but ultimately it'll do good, because you can come up with examples like, you know, would it be wrong for me to stick a knife in your throat? Well, not if you need an emergency tracheotomy. And so once you convince people that roughly what they're doing is giving the world an emergency tracheotomy, all of a sudden all of their evil is good in their eyes. That's the poison that religion injects society with, because it is concerned about, you know.
And if you can convince them that the people that they're harming are evil and you know, doing damage and harm and deserve to die, and that
if somebody's standing over a little kid and is about to plunge a knife into the little kid, all of a sudden you feel like you're justified to just shoot them in the head. Well, if you take that literal situation and turn it into a metaphor, where now it's perhaps the government has a metaphorical knife at your kid's throat, then you mm-hmm. have a justification to oppose the government. And in some cases, that's the case. But whether or not the situation is accurately represented is the issue.
Okay. Yeah, because, like, what we get here, believe it or not, we do get creationists, but they're not that vocal. Because it's a normal, it's perceived as normal to believe that, and the absence of science in schools. But it's surprising to me that in some areas they have this vacuum of empathy. Because recently we had this trial where this woman, she miscarried, but people interpret that as she deliberately and with conscience killed her baby, and she spent years going in trials in and out of prison because they don't understand the concept of miscarriage and abortion, that one is just a coincidence and the other one is that has a deliberate thought of doing so.
Yeah, if you're talking about the case, if you're talking about the case that I heard about, she's actually convicted and in prison at this moment, right? No?
Was that ever? Yes, sadly.
Yes, she is.
Okay. Yes. He said she is. So maybe we're talking about different cases, or maybe you're talking about a different case. I have somebody shaking their head who I trust and adore, just to say. Anyway, thanks for calling, Ben. I appreciate it.
Love the show, man. Love the show.
Thank you.
Thanks for hanging with us during our hiatus. Yeah, I was. I did 20 days in Australia, came back for 4 days, then went to Memphis for a week for the American Atheist Convention, came back and did the University of Texas at San Antonio, and then a Skype thing with the University of Illinois, and this coming week I leave for Manchester. I'll be in Manchester, United Kingdom, for QEDCon. So, and I'll get to, I'm going to shoot an interview with Professor A.C. Grayling while I'm there.
Oh, that's nice.
So, yeah. How do you not love a trip like that, even if it's just a few days? But hopefully we'll continue to fix phones, and I think this has gone incredibly well considering how things looked about
well,
2 minutes before
rolling.
We went live. So let's
get a few more people been waiting.
So Emily, are you still there? Whoops, there we go. Now after saying that, the phone thing's not working.
Is that that's two, right?
Line two, just set line two live. If there we go. Emily, are you there?
Yes, I'm here. Can you hear me?
Yes, thanks for waiting.
Awesome. Thank you. So I was wondering if you guys had any views on whether or not atheists can benefit from like 12-step programs that seem to say that they seem to require a belief in God. And I wanted to know what you guys think about that.
Can someone benefit from such a program?
Yes.
I think, yeah, the answer would have to be yes. But I think that the programs themselves are not really as good as they sometimes claim.
Every time I talk about AA, I get hate mail.
Yeah, and there are, I know people who are secular-minded who both say that they really benefited from the support, and other people who say that it was a mess for them and didn't help, and that they did better off on their own or with other types of support. The 12-step programs are, I don't know, I mean, I suppose they can be supportive, and if somebody wants support and they don't have that support anywhere else, you know, maybe that program helps them. I've talked to a few people who said that they did kind of feel helped by the network of people. But as far as I think the efficacy of the programs themselves, I've not really heard too much positive about that.
Let me see if I can address this topic and at least change the nature of the hate mail that I'm going to get. I despise 12-step programs with a passion beyond words. Because when I look through the 12 steps, I see something that encourages victimhood. I can't do this. I can't solve it on my own, which I recognize. I'm not saying that people don't need help, but when they start applying it to a higher power. But here's what I've been told about AA and other 12-step programs. What kind of group you're in is going to vary from place to place. There are some that place far more importance on the higher power and whether or not it's God or God as you view him, or higher power could be, I guess, your chandelier in some groups. Because it's higher and has light. All right, anyway, the jokes don't work when you have to explain them. The other thing is that the effectiveness of a group is dependent upon the individual, how motivated they are, and the type of people who happen to be in that group. And so what I think is happening is that I have concerns that people are replacing one addiction for another. They're replacing whatever their substance that they're addicted to with an addiction to the group and the program. Now, I will say this before I go any further. If you are in a 12-step program and it's working, good for you. You're probably better off sober, even if you manage to get some wooey crap stuffed in your head as well. If you are currently addicted and a 12-step program is the only reasonable program for you in your area that you can engage with, you know, if there's no secular sobriety or anything like that, by all means, I would rather have you sober and healthy and feeling better, even if you end up believing in a God, provided that that doesn't also, you know, catastrophically descend into a whole bunch of other harms. I'm not opposed to people getting help. I want people to get help. I would just prefer that we learn more about addiction, learn more about substance abuse, learn more about how the human brain works, why some people are more prone to things than others, and teach people how to help themselves with reason and science and good evidence. Because one of the things that we do know fairly well about AA and other 12-step programs is that they are not very forthcoming and honest about their efficacy. The rates of recidivism seem very low for those programs because, in their view, if you go out and start drinking again, then you've failed the program. The program didn't fail you. And I think that is a ridiculously naive and inaccurate way of assessing the effectiveness of a program. But we're completely out of time. So far as I know, we'll be back again next week. Thanks, everybody, for calling in. Thanks for people hanging out in the studio. Thanks, Tracie. We'll see you then. Bye-bye.